or if it is at a bill stage. As a regular feature, we have a pre-budget memorandum that we submit to the Finance Ministry, and after the submission of that, they call upon us and we have a meeting with the Joint Secretaries and the CBDT members in Delhi. The major focuses what we require are debated, deliberated, and once they are done, they do even get back to us for asking certain clarifications. One of the issues I very well remember is that they are asking for the TDS problems, that how to meet those TDS problems, and the awaited portion is over, the part is over. Now we welcome the members to Pannu to the dais.
So that is how this idea was occur anything. But you know, we were lucky that last two attempts we had, this is like the third course, last two courses which we did, members have given a very good response, and this time also we are very happy that we are having a very good response from all of you. In fact, I was told that one of the participants has enrolled all the way from Ahmedabad, and this is the beauty of this course, that you know, the chamber only does this program. So that is the idea behind which this whole course. With this idea we started, and we are really moving in the right direction, I think. We are really fortunate enough that when we approach someone like Honorable Pannu sir, also Deepak bhai, and various other faculties will be dealing with this topic in the 4 half days which we are having. They were all eager and enthused, and you know, they were in fact, you know, with us. They said, yes, yes, this is a good course and we will be with you. And we never had any difficulty of getting any faculty. So that is the beauty of this course. Those who have enrolled this for this course, in the next 4 half days will be all more learned and more educated. With that background, friends, welcome to this study course on interpretation of statutes. And I have a pleasant task of introducing two eminent faculties which we are going to have the benefit now, and of course the third will join soon. First of all, keynote speaker Shri G.S. Pannu sir. He has been qualified as a chartered accountant, our own fraternity member. He has been practicing as a chartered accountant before joining as a member in the ITAT from 1986 to 2000. And he has, during his career, he was very active with the Northern India Regional Council of the Institute of Chartered Accountants. And before joining the ITAT in September 2000, he was the chairman of the Northern India Regional Council. And he has been previously posted at various benches of tribunal, including Bangalore, New Delhi, Chandigarh, Pune. And presently, we are fortunate that Pannu sir is in Mumbai bench. Whenever we have an occasion to appear before him, he hears us very well, and that is the so we are really thankful to him for that. Our other eminent speaker is Shri Deepak Thalshawala, who is also an advocate, and he has, after completing his education, he has been with articles with Bhai Shankar Ranga and Vidala. He has also appeared in fact IAS examination and was part of the income tax department. He was a commissioner in the income tax department earlier. He worked in various capacities, right from assistant director, assistant income commissioner to commissioner. He was on deputation for 2 years to International Institute of Public Administration at Vienna. He worked as a departmental representative also in income tax appellate tribunal. And presently he is practicing as an advocate before ITAT and High Court, Mumbai High Court. He was posted at Ahmedabad as a CIT, and then now was back to Mumbai. He is an accomplished trainer. He is having headed the training division of the IT department in Mumbai. He was visiting faculty at Jamnalal Bajaj Institute of Management. He has been also a recipient of the Finance Minister's Award for Outstanding Service. And Mr. Thalshawala is practicing in the tribunal and High Court, as I say. With this, I will present before you both the dignitaries, and I request you all to welcome them. Before I request Honorable Pannu sir to please do the keynote address, may we have the blessings of the Lord Saraswati, and then we start our process. Thank you.
Mar. Statutes in all kind of varied situations, but interpretation by itself, perhaps I think it's got the, we all know what an interpreter is. So perhaps the job of interpreter is to make you understand a language which you don't know otherwise. So, and this is perhaps, it's a paradox that we are all trained professionals, and yet when we are called upon to read a statute or the Income Tax Act to be precise, then we are again called upon to follow the rules of interpretation as if we are illiterate. The question is not that whether we are literate in law, but when we look at the rules of interpretation, perhaps the task which needs to be done is to find out the intention of the legislature. After all, what is interpretation? You see, it is very much possible that even when we converse, when we talk to each other, when you're talking to each other or your friend on the phone, especially on the mobile, maybe for the same network or otherwise, you do not catch the full words. So there's something is missed out. But then suddenly it does happen that you use such words which do not convey the right meaning. So immediately you are on the back foot with your friend, and then you again come back and communicate and say, sir, this is not what I meant, this is what I meant. So perhaps that is what, you know, that is the concept which goes on to even in the interpretation of the Indirect Taxes Act when we look at it. We have to look at it, what is the legislature trying to convey to us, to the stakeholders which are there, for the taxpayers, for the tax administrators, as to what is in the mind of the legislature when they drafted their statute. So that's what interpretation is all about. And now another aspect which we need to fully understand is, in our studies we were talking on the way that even in the CA curriculum we had those study material which would deal with the chapter on the rules and interpretation and everything, and we used to really perhaps like all of us or maybe I would all out mug it up and go and write my exam. But because rarely you learn these things without testing it in the practical arena. It's only when you are faced with a situation that you learn as to what are the rules of interpretation. We all know the principles of interpretation, the purpose of interpretation, it should be liberal, it should be constructive, it should be strictly to be construed, penal provisions to be strictly construed, cadence mischief rule, and so on and so forth. We all know that. But these are tools to arrive at, to understand and correctly implement what the legislature wants you to do. These rules are not by itself ends. They are only means to an end, whereby you have to evaluate and find out what does the legislature intend to do in the entire scheme of the act. So therefore, whenever we look at applying a particular proposition of interpretation rules to a section or to a situation, we must be always guided by one question as to, will it bring out correctly the intention of the legislature? Obviously, your speakers will take you through each of these topics of what is the mischief rule, the purpose of the little construction, departure from the law rules, when it is permissible. All those things are definitely, they are very, very pertinent, and obviously they will be required to understand the subject. But one must not forget, and my only emphasis is that one must understand the law in a way as the legislature has intended you to understand it. One. Two, you see, it does happen at times that sitting in our offices, we read the language once, and we feel that for the next 10 years, unless there is an amendment by the Finance Act, I am done with it. But believe me, so it's not so. Every time when a client comes to you for a case for opinion, or whenever an issue comes before you to be argued before a court of law, or maybe tribunal, maybe CATP, maybe for assessing authority, whenever there is a question related to a section, please open the act again, read the section again. Because as many times as you read a section, you will get as many questions in your mind, you will probably find as many interpretations involved there. And I can share with you that I was a young child in 1984. filed and qualified. And in 1986 itself, I had a case for I went to a senior advocate who, of course, is not known more, but you very, very well established human being at that point of time. And the issue related to was a bonus payment in the 36 section or something. So we all went prepared, the books ready, everything ready, and went to the, for a conference. We were youngsters, about half a year, 6 months of earlier practice, and didn't carry the income effect. So we thought, well, bonus per million, 36, yeah, all good. But to my dismay, the gentleman, the moment he looked at our brief, he read through that 2 page note which we had prepared for him, he immediately pulled out the income tax act and started reading the section. It really hit me at that point of time, and I still stand by that learning today when I'm here, even till today, that whenever there is a question which comes up, you must and must read the section again. It will give you an answer which you are looking for, the issue which is before you. You would probably know what the section is, you would know its basic, how it is designed, but the question that you have in mind, the pitfall which your interpretation can have when you go up before the authorities, they will all open up once you read the, that section, once the issue, in the background of the question that you have in your mind. So therefore, this is one thing which I feel that whenever we attempt to look at a section and apply it in our daily life, whenever you are faced with a situation as consultants, you must and must go back to the bare act before you start looking at the commentaries and start looking at what in what case law what has been said. Those are things which will follow. But the basic thing is that you yourself should understand as to what the section is trying to convey to you. And one other thing which perhaps your chairman said that I should talk about is how does the courts view and how does the courts look at the sections and what all is expected from the court when there is some ambiguity. See, first of all, one must understand it's not the courts who probably are going to make the law or they are going to write the law. They may at best write the understanding of the law which is before them. So therefore, there are not constraints. There is definitely a constraint on the court of not transgressing what is not expected of the section or whatever the statute therefore is there. So therefore, whenever you get up and plead for a relief based on a certain statute, you must be aware that there is always there is another side to it, and the court will take a middle path. The court will definitely take a view which in all probability would go by what the legislative intent is. Again, that is the basic philosophy in there. See, taking up the topic, what probably the Supreme Court will definitely do it much better, but it's still another topic here. That the Hayden's rule. So, nothing better can be illustrated than by this rule that as to what is that as to the legislative intent which is manifested everything that we do in the interpretation. You would be aware of what the Hayden rule is, I'm sure. Well, what it requires is that you look at what the old provision was and what were the pitfalls or what were the negatives in that provision and what were the reasons why there was a new provision which a new act which had been brought out. All the three things kept together can give you the understanding as to what is intended by the new statute. So therefore, there also the emphasis is on trying to understand as to what is the correct interpretation. The correctness has to be benchmarked vis-a-vis the intent of the legislature. And that is how our courts have been interpreting it. Of course, there are situations where certain beneficial provisions, as they are, sometimes they are read down in favor of the taxpayers. Yes, there is a concept, we are all aware of that, and but at the level of the tribunal, people who are getting into the tribunal, you will appreciate that that's quite a rarity. Of course, it is more prevalent in both the High Court and the Supreme Court, whether they do in certain situations impliedly read down certain strictness in the beneficial provisions and provide relief to the taxpayers. Of course, the tribunal they have to follow it, but it's seldom done at the level of the tribunal, because being a creature of the Act, we do not have those kind of constitutional powers which are vested in the High Court and the Supreme Court. So therefore, when you come before the tribunal, when you come with an interpretation which involves such a situation, maybe you can at best take it as a case where you will build up a case before the tribunal, but perhaps you should not be looking at something that the tribunal will be able to help you with. So that's one limitation which probably the ADP or tribunal would have in that situation. I mean, Mr. Deepak, to this vaccine day, will tell you better, of course, in his session. But that's how it is. And other aspects which, if you, I would rather be comfortable that if you have some questions, I would be more happy to answer and rather share and move your doubts if you have any, and rather than my being a monologue and I keep telling you things. Because there are so many things in the question, I don't want to prejudge the sessions, because there's such detailed topics which have been enumerated that possibly it will not be justifiable that we pick it up and finish it in 30 minutes time. So I would rather, if you face any practical situations, I'll be able to answer it very, very much better.
Somebody, if any member is having any question in general, without going to the specific sessions which we are having, if you have anything in general which sir is ready to answer, so please, if you have something, you can put it.
So whenever the tribunal matters are argued, and suppose some both the sides do not cite some particular judgment, of course, it could be the Supreme Court then, or a jurisdictional High Court. But then, without giving opportunity to other party, whether those judgments are considered, how you will go about it? Suppose some on some particular point, some judgment is there that is not cited by other party.
See, well, this is your interpretation, of course. But see, yes, I appreciate. See, what happens is in a typical hearing, the counsel of the SSC would be citing, say, two cases, three cases which are in his favor. And then they are, as we all know, that they are not that well prepared because of whatever reasons. So they, the possibility is that perhaps he is not able to cite a case which is in his favor.
Yes.
In all fairness, if the bench is aware of that case, then what is expected of the bench is that the bench can put it across to the SSC's counsel so that the party can meet with that situation. But that is not what you have in mind. But it may happen at times that you will find an order.
While passing the order.
While passing the order, tribunal takes into consideration a case law which is not cited before it. And it has been used to decide the issue, possibly against the SSC, only then the issue will
arise.
If we decide the issue in your favor, see, yes, it is not a very called for practice, because obviously if there is some conflict of the principle of natural justice, that is, if there is something which is against a person, you must bring it out and maybe confront with it, but still follow the same, it's a little matter. Normally this is not a practice which is followed by the benches. But yes, the same may not be true for a Supreme Court judgment.
Yeah.
If there is a judgment of Supreme Court which is neither being discussed in the hearing court or in the course of hearing, but it has come across to the members subsequently, if they use it and they choose to go against one of the parties, then possibly they cannot be, unless you are able to make out a case that yes, it was not applicable to you. But these are very rare situations. Perhaps the benches all across, maybe one person here and there, it may happen. Normally it is not done, it is not expected on the benches, and they don't do it, I suppose. You, I don't know, your experience, there might be some cases where they are not saying that there is 100%, there can be out of, you see, there is a dilemma at times, I'll share with you from the bench. at times it does happen that during the course of the hearing, you are genuinely and you are bona fidely going along with what the arguments are taking place in front of you. But there are situations when later on when you read, when you go to the fire and you look at the brief again and you're in the chambers, you will come across, for example, if you may come across a judgment of your own judicial high court, which possibly is different to what you have understood during the course of hearing. Yes, in such a situation, the right course would be to perhaps again go back to the court and then again put it across to the parties, yes. But yes, but there is a possibility that the bench may decide to use it and, you know, pass an order. But that's a rare situation. Normally, we find that in out of 199% cases, the person concerned will come up with definitely and bring up the Bombay High Court judgment, saying this is the judgment of the Indian court, and therefore, it will not be the notice. These are rare situations.
Yeah,
perhaps it should be avoided, of course. That is right. Anything else?
So when it comes to cross-border transactions and the issues are related to treaties, that the same principles will apply.
See, you have a topic here which deals with that. But see, there are two things. When we look at, when we understand the rules of interpretation, you must always keep in mind two exceptional situations. One, when you read the judgments. Another is when you read the treaties. When you read the judgment, they are not issues of, they are not language of a statute. So you must understand the judgment as it is written and for the purpose which is written. So therefore, the typical rules of interpretation may not be relevant when you read and try to understand the judgment. Similar to the situation, even with a treaty. Treaty is an understanding between the two countries. So what you have to look for is what is the understanding between the two treaties, between the two countries. And that's how even the Supreme Court, Justice Bhopal's statement in Azadi Bachao, they are also trying to explain in the same way. Treaty basically the understanding between the two countries, they are not amenable to be read as statutes. So therefore there will be some of the interpretation which perhaps would not be applicable in those situations. So you have to read the treaty and try to interpret it and understand it and construct it, perhaps with the intention as to what is the understanding which is country, rather than normal rules of interpretation. Of course, I think we have a topic.
Yes, we have a topic next time.
Yeah. Anything else?
About binding nature, sir. Some other high court judgment is there and special bail judgment is there of a particular area. Then I think special bail judgment, if suppose the bench feels that judgment is not speaking judgment or may not be a right judgment, then still they follow that special bail judgment in preference to high court judgment. For example, I can give an example that 115J, there was a judgment of Ken Oil. Ahmedabad tribunal has followed that the issue was whether advance taxes to be paid. Earlier the provision that same as otherwise that provision was not there. So, but the Bombay High Court said the advance tax is not required to be paid. And whereas when that provision has come, same as otherwise all other provisions will apply, then Mr. Ishwar has passed that order on in the case of Ken Oil. That in preference to High Court judgment, that the tribunal will pay.
But, that can be a very case specific thing, because if you are sitting in Bombay, you can't obviously follow a special bench and say, I thought this was my
name. No, it was in Ahmedabad. Ahmedabad bench versus Bombay.
That's an exceptional situation. Yeah. Because of the amendment, perhaps, which came in later. Otherwise, all of us, 126 members sitting together, cannot override a high court. Even if it is non jurisdictional. If there is a singular high court on an issue, we are bound to follow wherever we are sitting.
That principle of
Gurdav
Sharam.
But yes, that situation that the expression save as others provided came into the statutes and departed from what the Bombay court said. Anything else? Any youngsters who wants to?
Any young members who wants to ask questions specifically? Thank you, sir.
So now I think I must
beforehand, I must compliment the chamber. I know it's 90 years old it is now. So it's creditable that you still have the capacity to do things. And you're doing the study course. And I'm going to present the next one probably in the moot.
That. We have already released the test note.
Okay.
And all the law colleges in Mumbai will be participating. We have invited.
That's good. So keep the activities as vibrant as possible. And sharing of knowledge is something which will enrich everybody. No one becomes poorer by that. So good luck and all the best to all of you. Thank you.
Friends, we are really thankful to Pannu for spending his time, and I am able to witness the situation what he is facing today. The time schedule of today, his time schedule was so tight, you know, I witnessed that when I was sitting with him in his chamber, but still, in spite of all the busy schedules which he is carrying, he has been kind enough to be with us and always encouraging us. Thank you, sir, for a very elaborate discussion on some of the core principles of implementation, what the implementation actually means. With that, friends, the tone is set for us to go to the next session, where we will understand the concept of interpretation in general, the general purpose of general introduction to the word interpretation, what is the fundamental principles of interpretation. Before that, we have an eminent person in the form of Shri Pannu. I would request Dipak bhai to please take up the proceedings. Thank you.